Good morning. Welcome. I'm glad for each of you that arrived and are here on site. For those of you in your living room, family room, or maybe even in a hotel room because you've been traveling, I welcome you to this Palm Sunday worship from Liberty. I'm going to invite you to think about something, especially if you're online. When I can't have you respond to me at the door, why don't you just send an email saying, here's something I'd like you to pray for, here's something that I rejoice about in my life, and I'd love to hear from you. If you have the church email, you could do it. If you're visiting us on the service today, just go to our website, LibertyLB, and you will be able to send a note to the pastor from that site. God's Word, Psalm 118, 19 to 29, as I read it this morning. The very first verse is a verse that my mom often quoted to me after a serious time of illness. I didn't die, I lived. And now I'm telling the world what God did. God tested me, He pushed me hard, but He didn't hand me over to death. Swing wide the city gates, the righteous gates. I'll walk right through and thank God. The temple gate belongs to God, so the victors can enter in praise. Thank you for responding to me. You've truly become my salvation. The stone the masons discarded as flawed is now the capstone. This is God's work. We rub our eyes. We can hardly believe it. This is the very day God acted. Let's celebrate and be festive. Salvation now, God. Salvation now. Oh, yes, God. A free and full life. Blessed are you who enter in God's name. From God's house we bless you. God is God. He has bathed us in light, adorned the shrine with garlands, hang colored banners above the altar. You're my God. I thank you. Oh, my God, I lift high your praise. Thank you. God, you're so good. Your love never quits. Gracious Father, as we bow in your presence today, we give you thanks for your great gift to us, for your love toward us, and for your presence with us. We are grateful that on this Palm Sunday, we can lift our voices in praise, in hosannas, and be grateful. Bless our worship this morning. In your name, amen. Let's stand as we sing, and it's Palm Sunday, so guess what's coming?
Full of praise. morning. Today I'm going to be reading from Philippians 2. It's the epistle, but I'm going to read verses 1 through 11 instead of 5 through 11. And the title in my version, I have the ESV, says Christ's Example of Humility. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Lay your burden down, lay your burden down. Take your troubled soul, your tired mind, and lay your burden down. Lay your your feet on solid ground. Take your worries to the foot of the cross and lay your burden down. Lay your burden down. Lay your burden down. Take your weary life, your heavy load, and
I learned that Jesus is our rock and he will never fail us. No matter how much we sin, he will stay strong.
I like to come to camp because of all the opportunities you have, like ziplining, swimming, and all the fun things.
I learned the story behind like how Jesus died on the cross. I've read and heard about it, but during that Christ height, I actually felt like I experienced it and I was there.
I learned that in Christ we have hope, and our hope is secure, and it's also living, so like what better thing to put our trust in?
And I learned a lot more about the Bible and how important it is. Like, if you're doubting something or anything like that, it's really nice that you can just go to the Bible every day for that.
Since working on staff, it has totally changed the way that I live my life. Everything I do in life, just as God's Word commands us, is through the lens of the gospel.
He's like the only foundation that will really last. We can turn to a lot of other things, but they're not as firm as him.
Life without God is not satisfying. Culture changes, money isn't worth everything, but God is a never-changing, everlasting God.
He didn't create us to live for ourselves. He created us to serve, and camp is a really cool place to do that.
Every time, like when you come out to camp, you get to build a relationship with Jesus and you know more about him.
It's just an amazing camp. It's so fun, and I really would recommend it for all you who are watching this.
Brody, thank you, and I hope you paid attention to that video. Why today? Because we're coming up on the deadline to get discounts. And so if you haven't registered for camp yet, there's still time to do it. You can do it online. If you need help, Holly can help you. She's got the codes for getting the discount online. And I want to remind you that Liberty pays a significant portion of camp. So next Sunday at our Easter Sunday breakfast, we'll receive an offering for camp scholarships. And I pray that you come and be generous in that contribution. Today, in light of the weather, we are having a fellowship time, but as I mentioned before we went online, if you need to go home and want to get there before the storm hits significantly, take your coffee with you, or if you can stay, enjoy a few moments of fellowship with others who are here. Ladies' Bible study is scheduled for tomorrow night at 6:45. Stay tuned for that. We will also have only one service this Holy Week. It happens on Good Friday at 7. It'll involve communion, which on communion times we receive an offering for the Cold Water Fund, which assists people who are a part of our church who are in financial need. And so I trust that you will participate in that. The ushers after this offering will be at the door following worship for an offering for Matthias and Ellie Zabodi. Ushers, will you come as we receive the offering today?
Thank you.
Greetings from France. This morning, Ellie and I are thankful you're gathering this Mission Sunday to support us through prayers. We couldn't do what we do without the prayers of the church. We're doing well, and people have commented that Ellie is making good progress with her French. Since December, she's found new ways to practice her conversation skills outside of daily class while also helping others. As I write this, she's doing visitation at a nearby retirement home to spend time with elderly women who have no family nearby. The prayer request we want to communicate to you this morning is not for us, but for a couple we met at church. Please pray for Elvin and Mashed. They are Iranian believers who recently immigrated to France because Mashed, the wife, was in danger of facing consequences for becoming a Christian. In Iran, it's illegal to reach out or give, it's difficult to give up Islam. Elvin, her husband, grew up in a Christian home. The couple is currently applying for asylum in order to be allowed to stay and work in France. They're learning French at the same school where Ellie takes classes because they hope to be here for the long haul. They still don't know if their case will be approved. France is in the process of adopting stricter immigration laws, and while I don't know all the details of how this would affect religious refugees, it seems that applications like Elvin and Mashed's are often rejected. The church we attend is coming together to help this couple with their financial needs, but as the appointment they have this week with the immigration office, all we can do is pray. Pray that God would be a protector and provider for them, and also that he would nurture their faith as it's put to the test through these trials. We continue to keep you in our prayers. I think I'd like to be where they are today. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that you are the God who is present across the oceans to touch the lives of people that Matthias and Ellie are already ministering to. I pray for them as they continue to learn and to be able to serve you. Today, I pray for those who have injuries because of accidents. I pray for the many that died in Russia in this terrorist attack. Lord, those things are far removed from us, but there are things that are close to us. Surgeries anticipated, tests and treatments that are ongoing. And so I pray that you will be present with our friends and our church family who have these needs. Thank you that you're the God of comfort. Thank you that you're the God that sustains us in transitions. And so for Matthias and Ellie and the Matt Smith family, I pray that you would be ever present with them. Thank you for David and Janice as they prepare for ministry in Chad. And watch over Owen and Cammie as they assist mission families. We are grateful for the way you have met their needs and you promised to meet us. So bless us as we worship you together today and learn from your word. Help it to be something that impacts our life for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together. Thank you. morning when I put up the theme for this coming week, Guided to Grace, confirmation, we put the acrostic to that. I'm not going to ask him to say it with me right now, but I bet you remember it, don't you? What is it? You want to say it, don't you? No? Well, I knew one said no, but then you said, I know it, so I figured I'd let you say it. But God's riches at Christ's expense. What kind of person can experience grace? The passages of Scripture that were sent in the Saturday email or on the little reading guide would be helpful to you. This was a very different week for followers of Jesus Christ years ago. They celebrated, waved palm branches. Thought it was going to be really good. As the week progressed, things didn't turn out the way they had anticipated. What was looked like a road to being king became a road to being crucified. Along that journey, they only had one thing to depend upon, and it didn't always seem to impact them the way it would later in life. We know that during this week, one would betray, another would deny, many would go into hiding. So I want to talk a language that comes out of the passage that Holly read for us from Philippians 2. It's not a prevalent word in today's 21st century. The word is humility. People brag about all their achievements. They hold themselves up above others, and it makes people feel awfully uncomfortable. So we could gather this morning, and we could talk a language that's a little easy for us. We could talk about the weather. We could say all kinds of things that by the end of the day, may not be true at all. We could talk about how busy we are, how all of life is just crowded in on us, and we got a to-do list that's this long and this much time. We could talk about that. Some of you maybe have been shopping. You notice that the price of groceries isn't what it used to be. I realized that a lot of the things that I enjoyed doing as special outings are now 20% higher than they were. Ah. But I want you to think differently this morning. I want us to think and focus in on the Bible language that we heard from Philippians 2. I want us to think about the word atonement and forgiveness, and I want us to reflect a little bit on the Lamb of God. As though we're entering into a world that's so dissimilar to ours, so unattached to the life we live, that it's going to take some intentionality to learn the language of our God. We can't learn it by study alone. It isn't human to think the way Philippians 2 recorded for us, or to grasp what we're going to read in John chapter 13 in just a few moments. Matthias said to us, Ellie's learning French. What does it feel like to learn a language you didn't know and try to communicate it to a people that have lived in it and learned from it and understand it well? I know that when I took French, I stumbled often, said things that were embarrassing, did things with it that just made me, wow, I shouldn't have done that. Let's borrow the language of humility and take a look at it as it's displayed in John chapter 13, where we'll read verses 12 through 20. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. Do you understand what I've done for you? He asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I've set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you have know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. I'm not referring to all of you. I know those I have chosen, but this is to fulfill this passage of Scripture, he who shared my bread has turned against me. I'm telling you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am who I am. Very truly I tell you, whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me. The details of this foot washing are well known to us. The disciples were already eating when Jesus waited as long as he could, and he took upon himself the role that they should have taken when they began to gather. The custom of coming into another's home indicated that you would wash their feet, that you would humble yourself and do for them what was very uncomfortable. I can imagine their faces became hotter than their feet when he put on the apron and the towel and knelt before them. I suspect there was an awkward silence until he came to Peter. Do you remember when we did the foot washing here one Monday, Thursday? I remember going with the towel. We had a towel that everyone took home. I think we still have ours. It had forgiven on it. And one of the things that I discerned and discovered was when I came to wash someone's feet and asked them to take off their shoes, no, not me. Not me. Peter is approached by Jesus, about to have his feet washed, and he says, not me. He blurted out what all the others wanted to say, and all Jesus said to him, if you know these things, happy are you if you do them. Knowing, that's kind of an intellectual response. You understand what ought to go on, and you've got it clear up here, but happy is an emotional response. Receiving from Jesus that which he longs to give. Doing it involves the will. It seems to me that Jesus here pleads for a humility of the whole being. Let me just say three things this morning about this humility that to know and happy and do involves. First of all, it's a humility of the mind. He knew them, but they were fighting against what they knew. They knew that the foot washing was an important component of their lives. They had knowledge of it. Jesus, knowing more than all, put on the apron and did more than all who had the opportunity to do it. He began to wash their feet. It's an exciting knowledge that we can value the truth of God's word in ways by thinking about it on our mind, and yet we can learn it all and be led to the foot of the cross, which was sung for us today, lay your burden down. And so we still have some things to learn. The Bible stories that we approached in our youth are still there, but are we thinking on them? We have a knowledge that is inadequate and sometimes forgotten, and so the fastest way to become proud and put humility aside is to quit learning. We think less of the things that relate us to God and more of the things that relate to our fellow men, to our family, and to the world in which we live. Have we also learned more about God? Were we kind of lethargic and apathetic about that? We can often accuse people of significant intelligence who can explain to us the atomic bomb or the function of some intricate piece of software. We accuse them of being stuck up in their knowledge. They lack humility. We should begin understanding that we, like them, often lack humility. So there's a humility of the mind, but there's also a humility of the emotions, of the heart. That's equally difficult. Peter had not learned. He and John had come to the upper room first. Evidently, they had argued along the way. My suspicion is they come to this gathering of the followers of Jesus awaiting his arrival, and they're kind of sulking. I'm better than you. And the response is, no, I'm better than you. You entered into arguments like that? Have you found yourself putting yourself above another, and your emotions get the best of you, and in the sulking, no one wants to wash dirty feet. A few moments later, Peter goes the other way. We see him swinging often in his attitudes and words, don't we? When he realizes that Jesus is going to wash his feet and to cleanse him and to forgive him, he says, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Now he offers an exaggerated obedience, like an actor who can turn the tears on and off during a play. Jesus says, no. Your sins are like the dust that appears on your sandals. And I'll show you the example. Towards Peter, and especially towards Judas, he says, what you do, do quickly. He doesn't take a whip and send him out. He speaks truth to him. Oh, he's not inviting us to become involved in an overly emotional way, but he is inviting us to be happy in doing what he's called us to. You get involved in some measure of emotion in the service? Do you sometimes, when you sing a song, just have that feeling in your heart or that attitude in your mind that almost causes you to stop singing because the Spirit of God has given you the emotion to respond to what is coming your way? Luther had a contemporary, Erasmus, who was much more brilliant. He could pass out a statement and study meanings of words. But when it came to the time to worship, he was like a spectator. Luther put his whole heart into the struggle, involved in every way. History tells that Erasmus died unhappy and frustrated. Luther, despite the deep scars and struggles, could sing and play the guitar. A summary of this part of what we are learning from God concerning humility simply says, if you know, blessed are you. Thirdly, humility reaches the total being. It involves us, it leads us to action. We get it here, and then we begin to ask the Spirit of God to kind of control our thinking and our minds and our emotions. And at times it will be a jubilance that causes us to laugh and rejoice. At times it will be that sense of response to the hymn or the scripture that's read that says, I needed that. It spoke to me. And when those two things happen, it kind of completes the trilogy that Jesus was after. Judas knew what the others knew, but he was deeply disturbed. But he would never find himself saying, your will be done. Here was Jesus, strength for his will, submissive to his Father that says, take my will and make it yours. The songs we've sung basically aren't difficult to sing. But sometimes when we attempt to sing some of the messages of the song that draw us into the presence of our Lord, our lips and tongue stammer. Because we're learning what it is to respond to Him in action. Humility probably is a language of another world. We don't see it often in this world. It's probably difficult to learn. It won't be an easy time for us, but it's worth listening. Listening to what Jesus said in verse 17. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. Are you willing to borrow the language from another world and make it yours during this Holy Week? So that as we humble ourselves, we begin to hear what God wants to do by His grace for us. He longs for us to be close to Him. He desires to be compassionate toward us in the things that are. He's the God who rescues us when we've walked our own way. The things we've damaged and the relationships that we have brought to tatters, He can change because He finished His mission. And at the end of the week, when we leave here on Friday, amid the darkness and despair that is felt when someone dies, there's another day coming. His endurance, His death, His suffering is what grants us eternal life. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. Let's stand and sing together hymn number 593. Thank you, Lord, that your word speaks powerfully to us. I pray that this week we will listen well to it, that we'll learn what it is to humble ourselves in your presence, which prepares us to be recipients of the marvelous grace of a loving God. So, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Before the benediction, before the doxology, I want to remind you that there's an offering for Zabotis at the door. Children, if you want to take the palm branches home, you can pick them up here. The last thing I think I will say is that there's food for the taking next to the cappuccino machine. If there's food you can use or you know someone you'd want to share it with, please help yourself while it lasts. And don't take it from someone that's already taken it, okay? Just saying. Benediction. Doxology.